Hey, Dr. C with you. So what are the signs and symptoms of iodine deficiency? For starters, let's talk about what this is, who might have it, and how you would know if it's there. In this video, you'll learn about how common this phenomena is, how likely it is to be present, what you would do about it, and how you would identify it. So let's dive on in. So for starters, let's get some context. Iodine is needed for the thyroid to make thyroid hormones. Those include T4 and T3. In fact, the 4 and the 3 are the number of iodine atoms in the particular molecule. The different numbers of them change how these hormones act and what they do in the body. Without iodine, we can't make thyroid hormones, and life itself could not exist. Even the most early primitive forms of life rely upon iodine as an energy-trapping molecule. However, there's some unique ways in which it works in the body. Most nutrients are kind of weird because you can take a little or a lot, and they're not harmful in most cases. Vitamin C, we need just a speck to prevent scurvy, like probably 5 or 10 milligrams per day. And on the other side of that, on the high end of the dosages, most can safely take 5,000 to 10,000 milligrams per day with nothing worse than a few loose stools. So we can see a range of literally 1,000-fold to where anywhere in there, you're probably okay on vitamin C. And we could talk about other vitamins and minerals and really similar ranges. We need some, we can get too little, but we're not commonly at risk for getting too much. But with iodine, it's just not like that. The other big difference is that iodine is the only one that has a special pump. So the body pumps it in to places where it wants it. And the pump exists because the amount needed in the thyroid are larger than the concentrations found in the blood, but also because it prevents it from being too much getting in the thyroid. So the pump helps to pull it in and then block it out. Because of this pump business, we have this narrow window to where if we get too much, either it builds up because of the pump or the pump shuts off and we get none. And so too much can look a lot like too little. And that range is probably no larger than 50 to 200 micrograms for a lot of people. So remember that vitamin C, we had like 1,000-fold range. Well, here we've got a 4-fold range. That's not very big. Now, thankfully, that's not hard to hit, but one can be outside of that range. And because of that, we can see issues of too much or too little. So how common is iodine deficiency? And I wanna differentiate being iodine deficient from having a low level of iodine. They're not the same thing. So hang with me a bit and make this distinction. In populations, we can test people and see what the average iodine status is for the population. There's a lot of great iodine tests that can look at large numbers of people. There's no great ones for individuals, but many can show if a population is sufficient or not. But if a population is not sufficient, it doesn't mean they get thyroid disease. So what's happening is, there's been a revamping of all the guidelines of what's too high and what's too low. And a lot of the old guidelines for what was too low, now we see aren't too low at all and are actually levels that are better for adults and less apt to cause adults to develop problems. So if we put aside low levels in a group or low levels in an individual, an iodine deficiency is a state at where someone has a specific change in thyroid function that and they're found to have an unusually low intake of iodine by various methods, including dietary analysis, and they're given a reasonable amount of iodine and the problem goes away. So all those things together are needed to confirm there was an iodine deficiency. You know, take goiter, for example. Many people have their thyroid enlarged for reasons that have nothing to do with iodine. So goiter alone is not proof of an iodine deficiency. But there have been cases where people had goiters and they had very restrictive, narrow, unusual diets, and they had measurable, very low levels of iodine, and their goiter resolved with a small addition of dietary iodine. Those things have happened. In terms of putting some context on that, there have been 7 documented cases in the last 42 years. So no exaggeration, about like 1 case every 6 years. Now, the other side of that, the cases where there's too much iodine, most experts argue that that's the driver of somewhere around 30 to 80% of adult thyroid disease. So if we've got 60 million people with obvious thyroid disease, and if somewhere around half of them per year are being caused by too much iodine, we can say there's like 30 million cases per year. Or over the case of 40 years, well, this is tricky math, 30 times 40 is going to be what? 1,200. So 1,200 million, so 1.2, that's too many. Yeah, because there's not that many cases cumulatively. But so somewhere around 30 million per year, put that against one case every 6 years. So that's how common too much is compared to too little. So how would someone know if they're on too little? Well, for starters, they can't be on thyroid medication. Thyroid medications supply all the iodine needed to make thyroid hormone. So once you're on them, by definition, you can't become iodine deficient. So if someone's not on medication, the other consideration is if they're on an omnivorous diet, they'll not become iodine deficient. So dairy foods, animal proteins, egg yolks, these all have a substantial amount of iodine. Animal proteins of all type, poultry, beef, pork, those types don't contain excessive amounts, but they do contain measurable significant amounts. So those who are consuming animal proteins of any form that are on omnivorous diets will not become deficient. Next up is those who consume salt that has iodine. That can be salt that is added iodine or salt that has naturally occurring iodine, such as pink Himalayan salt or sea salt. Those are also relatively good sources of that. So in those cases, we don't suspect iodine deficiency just due to those simple dietary factors. There have been questions about whether poor digestion or malabsorption of nutrients can be a factor in this, and it's not been shown to be the case. There have been populations that have inflammatory bowel disease, even those that have had gastric bypass or colon resections done, they do not have greater prevalences of iodine deficiency. So we don't think that you need very great digestive function to assimilate iodine. The most basic levels can get the job done. So then if those who are not going to be deficient, who could be deficient? Well, you need to have four criteria present. You need to be vegan. You would need to not be on thyroid medication. You would need to have no iodine in supplements and not be using iodized salt. One more bonus criteria, you'd not be consuming sea vegetables. So if those things apply, there is a chance one can become iodine deficient. And again, we've had 6-7 cases in the last 42 years. So it does happen, not common. What are the symptoms someone would look for? The first one is going to be a goiter, and that's a diffuse, even enlargement of the thyroid gland. You normally can't see someone's thyroid, but if they have a goiter, you can. You can see a pretty clear outline in about this area. Another big symptom is that their speech is generally strained. They may mention how it's difficult for them to speak, that they have to work harder at it, that it's hard to maintain as much volume to their voice, or they get worn out if they speak for longer periods of time. Another big symptom that can show up is difficulties with swallowing. And this is to where just that, like drinking water, swallowing food, they may notice that they need to chew things up down to nothing, or they get things stuck in their throat on the way down pretty commonly. Another one is called globus hystericus, and that's a fancy Latin name for a feeling of like a lump in the throat. And that's to where it feels like something is stuck even when there's not. People can walk around and have this sensation of fullness or pressure for no clear reason. Another one is wheezing. They may have difficulty breathing, especially they can feel that right around in this throat area. Another possible symptom we can think about would be heartburn. Now, heartburn is something to where you can have it, of course, from actual acid and reflux, but sometimes other pressure symptoms in this general area can mimic heartburn or feel like it. Another symptom is clothes feeling too tight around the neck. It can feel like you've got a tight collar, even if your collar is not particularly tight. One more can be food trapped in the throat. So you're swallowing things and some of it actually gets stuck. And you may have to cough to get that out or drink some water and gargle often. And the last one is voice changes. So your voice is more hoarse. Your voice is raspy. The voice is deeper. It's harder to maintain a normal timbre or tone you would have otherwise. And if we think these things through, all these symptoms relate back to that swelling, to that goiter. These are all symptoms of structural change of the thyroid itself. And that's one of the specific things iodine deficiency tends to do, is cause this enlargement to occur. Now, a funny paradox about goiter is that it can be a sign of iodine deficiency, but it can also come from iodine excess. And it can also come from reasons that have nothing to do with iodine. We know that populations that use more tobacco or more alcohol have higher rates of goiter. Also, heavier populations have higher rates of goiter, so body weight affects that. So many things can give rise to it. And just seeing a goiter doesn't mean iodine deficiency, but seeing a goiter in someone who's vegan, you know, no iodine in supplements, no iodized salt, no dietary sources of iodine, you know, then we start thinking it might be relevant. So what are the treatment options? What would someone do in those cases? You know, quite simply, dietary sufficiency can correct that. There is talk about the use of iodine in supplements, but the amount in supplements is really poorly made and not consistent. There have been many papers analyzing supplements showing that they don't have what you would think they have. So there are many good food sources that contain it. Egg yolks are one of my favorites. You know, egg yolks or half a cup of non-fat Greek yogurt. Those are really easy ways to get a reasonable amount of iodine on a regular enough basis. There was a case I saw once. This was probably the early 2000s. And this was a young man who had seen a motivational speaker, and he was all fired up about that. Pretty famous motivational speaker, I won't name names, but this young man was told that raw foods were the best foods, and the more raw foods you ate, the better, and that cruciferous vegetables were great. And this young guy, he was 19 or 20, and he took everything to such an extreme. He went and ran with it. And I don't know, it was funny, because I've done that so much in my youth. You know, if something is good, then more's got to be better. So he took it to the extreme. He ate nothing but raw vegetables and almost exclusively raw broccoli. And each day he had about 2 or 3 pounds of raw broccoli. And he would take it and mix it with some carrots, some lettuce, some celery, blend that up. That was food. And that was his diet exclusively for about 6 months. So the poor kid lost a whole lot of muscle tissue. He was wasting away. But he had this, you could see it across the room, he had a goiter. And his dad brought him in because a doctor wanted to put him on thyroid medication. And his dad thought maybe his diet had something to do with it. And I'm like, well, heck yeah, it does. So I didn't put the kid on iodine supplements. I said, you know, your diet is important and putting energy into it is an awesome thing. You can go a long way towards improving your health. But think more about how to nourish your body. Don't think about food as the enemy. Think about good natural food as your friend. And how can you get a good range of healthy food in your diet? How can you add in all these good food categories of, yes, vegetables, some of them cooked also, and fruits, and animal proteins, and all the rest? So he went back to a healthy diet, and over the course of the following months, his hypothyroidism reversed, and his goiter shrunk down. He was fine. And that's really how these cases can play out, as rare as they are. Again, the paradox is that too much iodine can cause these low iodine problems. And that's because your thyroid pumps it in. So when you get a lot of iodine, it stops it from taking it in. So some things that look like iodine deficiency can also be caused by iodine excess. All right, Dr. C here with you. That's how you'd go about knowing if you had an iodine deficiency and what you would do about that. Take great care, and we'll see you again really soon. Bye-bye.